morning and morning and welcome to my first pre-show ever. I have Dangerous Dave the Dish on camera, and of course I'm Brent Dowsmith, and now I'm on the northern edge of our Traverse area. I'm hoping to find some leopard tracks. That male leopard was calling through the night, so I'm checking some of Mr. Tingana's normal routes to see if he's around in the pre-dawn gloriousness that is the African bush. We've got some wonderful summer skies around. I mean, just look at those colors up ahead, directly to the east of us there. It is like a Turner painting, those colors, those skies. We are burning the cool weather. We need to find some tracks while it's still a little bit cold. I mean, it's already 23 degrees Celsius this morning, which is about 70 odd Fahrenheit. So, and it's been like that since about 4 a.m. So I think today is going to be a scorcher. No sign of any tracks yet, but we're going to pop down now towards Central Road, see if he's on his normal route. As I say, no tracks. It is the tracks of a honey badger. Impala. I maybe meander down towards Cheetah Plains this morning. I'm trying to look at the sky, see if the ominous weather is about. But I think the big storms and lightning we saw last night has all moved to the north, so completely bypassed us. It looks like it's from the darkness, it's up towards the Timbavati Kasseri area. But it is an absolutely stunning morning to be out and about in the African bush. I'm pretty sure the Nkomas are probably around where they were, so I'm not going to look for them just yet, see what else we can find. I think they're so fat and happy at the moment that they're not going to move too much. Jamie said there was still lots of meat on that kill. The cubs are getting so big so quickly. Very upset, Franklin. Let's go have a look. There's a Franklin alarm calling in here. It's often a bird of prey or a slender mongoose, but just every now and then, it is a leopard or a lion.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning and welcome to the African bush. It's just before dawn, the sun rises. We're in search of lions, leopards, cheetahs, wild dogs, and all the other fantastic animals out here. This is Safari Life.
Ready?
Standing by.
Welcome to the Sabi Sands Game Reserve in South Africa. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Dangerous Dave the Dish on camera, and we have another dishy animal next to us. They are beautiful striped patterns of the Burchell's or Plains zebra, munching away on a lovely bit of green flush from the last rains we've had. And we are being spoiled with the amount of zebra that are out and about in the African bush at the moment. That female looks like she might be carrying a bit of pregnancy weight. I'm not too pregnant though. I just want to go forward up. I thought I saw a nice little one. Here we go. Here we go. Hello, little one. A little foal. Hiding behind the fallen knobthorn. Now what's wonderful at this time of the morning is often some of the predators are quite vocal. I know the lions were roaring about an hour ago. Thank you to those damn cam aficionados who let us know. And of course, this is 100% live. You are looking at this young zebra munching away merrily, live from the African bush. And the wonderful thing about being live and sharing these wildlife experiences with you in real time is that you can ask us questions about what we're seeing. You can do that by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or pop an email to questions@wildearth.tv. Now, we've got some fantastic summer skies. That is one of the great things about this time of the year. We've got amazing clouds, and as you can see, we're heading east. I'm just gonna pop onto the crest of this hill so we can have a good look at the potential sunrise that's on the way. Here we go. Look at that. I do love these summer clouds. There we go. And while we give you a lovely view of this incredible early morning sky, I'm of course not the only one who's out and about in the African bush. So let's jump across and say good morning to Jamie.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari, and we've also got a view of an incredibly beautiful sky. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have Brian on camera with me, who's bringing you the images of that incredible sunrise. Morning, Thumb. I've missed the Thumb, Brian. And you, but the Thumb as well. The two of you are relatively inseparable. Hopefully inseparable. But good morning, everyone. We're going to be heading out into the African bush. It's such a stunning morning. The only problem is the promise of the rain that I thought was going to arrive at some point last night. So much so, I was so confident in my prediction that I even told Dave he was wrong and that it was going to rain. And I feel as though that was a grievous error on my part. I really shouldn't try and predict the weather because it didn't happen at all. However, in Johannesburg, for those of you who are not South African, I think most of the South Africans are aware, they will have seen the news. In Johannesburg, they got all of the rain that we really needed. Flooded the roads, people were stuck in traffic. It was actually incredibly intense amount of water. Looking at familiar places, because of course both Brian and myself grew up in Johannesburg, looking at familiar places on social media, absolutely underwater, essentially. Those of you who are South African maybe know of the road Jan Smuts outside the Johannesburg Zoo. Just watched vehicles pushing through the water. So it seems to have got stuck somewhere on the Highveld and hasn't quite made it over the mountains to us. You never know. I'm not giving up hope just yet. Perhaps it'll rain later today. Right, so the plan for this beautiful morning, now that I am back from leave, and it is really, truly wonderful to be back, is to bumble, essentially. I'm going to go check the southern boundary, see whether or not a Karula, the queen of Juma, the female leopard and her two... Nine-month-old cubs. Right, let me carry on towards the southern boundary. It sounds as though some of the other animals are waking up this morning. Let's go and see what Brent has found.
Well, look at this. A nocturnal wanderer heading back towards his daytime hide. Now, even though we have had some rain, there hasn't been enough to quite fill all the water holes, so some of the hippos are still struggling quite a bit. And you can see he's got quite a bit of mud on him. And he's not too far from the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. But we'll be taking advantage of the green flush. And the hippos have been one of the hardest hit over the drought, which seems to be mercifully over now. But I think he's going to be slowly making his way either towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole or to a very thick shaded area in one of the dry riverbeds to spend his time hiding from the harsh African sun, which is on its way. Now I think we might go have a quick check around the Nkuhumas. I also want to check Hippo Pools Road, because that is one of Tingana's favorite routes to walk in and out. If we get nothing that side, have a look at the Nkuhumas, then start heading back towards the west from there. Now, of course, the wonderful thing about summer is all the birdies. Lots of birdies. Now, yesterday, I got to see the one beautiful big Birmingham boy. And, there's some buffalo heading down towards Buffalo's Hook Dam, so we'll loop around. And Cavalier's wondering, why do the others not spend as much time with the... With the Nkuhuma pride at the moment. You probably find it's just estrus cycles. The sticks have lost their cubs, so they're going to be mating again. So you probably find the males are going to be spending a lot more time there. They have also recently acquired a third pride known as the Torchwood pride, which is mostly in Kruger. So they are obviously also spending quite a bit of time with the Torchwood pride. Now, interesting enough, we had that one beautiful big male on quarantine or around the Juma Dam cam there, but the three others were not too far away from where the Nkuhumas are on that buffalo kill, so who knows, maybe all four will be there on this sunrise safari. Okay, so we're going to just sneak up towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. That hippo, as I said, was sort of probably going to be moving parallel through here to the water. I just saw in the distance a buffalo bull, so I don't know if there's a breeding herd with him, but he seemed to be also heading straight towards the waterhole. So we'll go have a look. Hopefully, for his sake, he's not going to walk into a carpet of lions lying around the waterhole. It seems if lions look at buffalo at the moment, they fall over. This is also probably the closest permanent waterhole to where the Nkuhumas are on that kill, so they might possibly come down this area for a drink, but there could be some of the smaller water holes like Gwari Pan itself that might be holding water still. I haven't managed to get to that side of the reserve since I've been back, so quite exciting. No carpet of lions. But it is nice to see a fair bit of water, and look at that with the sky. Oh, it's a water buck though. Let me just get into a good spot here. There we go. Oh, and of course, let's have a quick listen while we're here. There's some water buck. And you have the very distinct call of the red-chested cuckoo. Slightly less appealing call of the red-billed buffalo ewers. And some Burchell starlings calling. Crested barbet, crested franklin. Oh, golden-breasted bunting. The dawn chorus is in full swing. Waterbuck coming down for their morning drink. It's always lovely to sit at this time of the day and just listen. There's so many beautiful sounds, and of course always the chance that the lions or leopards will roar. That's beautiful. Look at that reflection, that sort of golden light creeping through. Now this is the common waterbuck. Another species of waterbuck in Africa is the Defussa waterbuck. What did I hear? No, I thought I might have heard monkeys alarming in the distance, but I think it's just a funny sounding starling. Spectacular. Okay, so it sounds like Jamie's got some tracks, so let's go have a look what she's tracking.
I have some tracks indeed, and what a sight for sore eyes. I'm so chuffed. Exactly where we decided to pop out, on the southern boundary of Juma, and who should be wandering back across but the Queen herself, or has been wandering back across, the Queen herself, and from what I can see, her two cubs are with her. Now, those are leopard tracks, for those of you that are joining us for the first time, and such an exciting sight, because this is a main road, which means that there's constant vehicle traffic up and down it. And what that tells me is that these tracks are fresh. We've arrived at the perfect time before anybody's had a chance to get out and drive over them. If we jump out quickly, and I want to jump out for a couple of reasons. One is to see exactly where they go, and whether or not they go towards her, along her favorite path, along Treehouse Dam, or if they move further towards Philemon's cutline. Sorry, hello, don't mind me. Some zebra watching me with great consternation. So if we have a look at these tracks, and they are such beautiful tracks, my guess would be this is the queen walking along here. So this is the female leopard's tracks, the adult female, just judging by size. And they're perfectly crisp. You can actually see the three lobes at the back, and then the little toes. And her back foot, which is this one here, you see this one, Brian?
Yep.
The back foot has fallen pretty much on top of her front foot. So she's not stretching out. She's walking in a sort of relatively, a stroll. She's essentially strolling. Her tracks are here. The tracks of Shungile, the little female, were around here with hers. I think she's basically walked on top of them. And then, sorry, zebra. Sorry. And then I'm going to take a shot in the dark and say that this over here, which is slightly harder to see because the soil is very coarse in this particular spot, but I'm going to take a guess and say that this is Hosanna's tracks. Just in terms of size, it looks as though he might actually have overtaken his mom in terms of foot size. And now, we've got beautifully fresh leopard tracks. We've got a female leopard and her cubs. The reason that's exciting is generally female leopards will leave their cubs hidden somewhere safe while they go off and hunt. So the fact that she's come and fetched them and taken them in this direction suggests that she might have a kill somewhere. And when I left, Karula was doing an amazing job. Sorry, Zebra, making their morning very difficult. Karula was doing an amazing job of catching food and providing for her two gorgeous little ones. And I assume that that is continues. What I'm doing now, I'm just checking to see, bear with me one moment, I'm just checking to see exactly where they've gone. It looks like they're going straight through here towards those mud wallows. One of Karula's favorite paths. Now the question is just if she's gone onto Juma, which is fantastic news. If she's gone that way or if she's gone behind Brian. So let's go and find out. I'm so excited. Get a chance to see her. I'm also really slightly nervous as I drove past her. I hope we didn't, Brian. I'm going to be very embarrassed. It takes a while to get your eye back into the swing of things, I find. And I'm sure it's the same for cameramen. Is it the same, Brian? Must be. When you've been on holiday for a little while, you forget how to look. Forget how to see. Well, at least I didn't miss these tracks. Aren't they beautiful, Anna Marie? You're absolutely right. Those tracks are so deep and so clear. They're just perfect. It's my favorite thing on a morning like this morning, seeing fresh, clean, clear leopard tracks. I think it's a very much a guide, maybe not just a guide thing, but I feel like we get the tremendous sense of excitement when we see something like that. And so when it's on a main road and you see it on top of all of the vehicle tracks, you just know that the leopard is somewhere close. Now, I don't think I missed the tracks on this road. I was checking quite carefully. Ah, this is brilliant. We've got the new road, the Firebreak Road, which will help us out tremendously in terms of figuring out if she's gone, carried on this way. Ooh, gets a little tricky here. Or if she's moved a little bit further to the west. Don't mind me, I'm not ignoring you. I'm just double checking to see that the tracks cross here, which I'm sort of hoping and expecting that they do. Make sure that I'm not so busy looking at the tracks that I miss the leopard. Maybe not. Should see them with three separate tracks. Okay, so maybe not this way. Those tracks are so fresh, you can almost, not quite, but you can almost smell the animal that made them. Okay, let's go and check Treehouse Dam. This road's a little damp. And of course, one of the biggest reasons why I'm so keen to see Karula and her cubs is to see how much those adorable cubs have grown. And James, you say I won't believe how much they've grown, and they are absolutely amazing, and that you're very keen to see Karula and cubs. Ooh, I'm really, really excited. It's the first thing when you work regularly in an area and you go away for a little while. One of the most exciting aspects is to have a chance to see the animals that you've come to know so well. And just how big the little ones have got. And I was treated to the Nkuhuma cubs yesterday, which is always a joy. And they have grown tremendously since I left. And now it's just a question of tracking down and finding the queen and the royal family. I'm going to do some serious concentrating on exactly where these leopards have gone. And while I do that and go for a little stroll, let's head across to Brent, who's managed to find the first scavenger of the morning.
Look at that. We're approaching the area where the incredible Nkuhumas are. And all the vultures are still up in the tree, which is a good sign that the lions are still here. There's a lot of tracks on the road. They went to a small little mud wallow for a drink and now seem to be heading back towards the kill site. Let's keep going. Now, get ready for a screenshot. So I want to get Dave to zoom in on those vultures. And as we sneak forward, let's see who can get a flying screenshot of one of the vultures. And remember to share it with us. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Pop it on our Facebook page. So I'm going to edge forward. I'll try to keep as steady as possible for you, Dave. Is that... Wait a second. Oh, it is a hooded. Okay. I'm going to switch off so there's even less vibration as we roll towards the vultures. Who's going to be the first to fly? There we go. None of them quite flying in the right direction. Here you go, you can see white-backed vultures and a hooded vulture in between. I can hear a lion. Did you hear that, Dave? Where's the lion? There's a lion. I heard him. A little call. There's a lion cub. There's a lion cub in a tree. What are you doing up there, Horror? In the weeping wattle? That was not a very graceful dismount at all. Oh, next one wants to go up. Whatever you can do, I can do better. Here we go, you hear that, ooh, that's what I heard. So I can just see two littlies at the moment. Oh, there's more behind us. I can hear lions all over the place. We can only see these two at the moment. Can hear a hyena calling in the distance as well. Well, we are on the most incredible cat streak at the moment, and Fran is wondering what's it on. And as far as to my knowledge, it's on 61 days so far. Someone coming in behind us. Hello, Mom. Can you hear another lion calling? Here we go. One of the adult in Kahumas. Now, the nice thing about lions at this time in the morning is we might get some quite playful interaction. Oh, sorry, you just heard that. Well, they literally just collapsed out of the tree. Mom. So I'm just going to keep quiet and let you listen to these incredible sounds. Mom's going climbing. What are you doing? Let's just try and get around quickly. Isn't this incredible? Mom perched. Reliving her youth. Oh, here we go. Here comes trouble. I don't think there's enough space for all of you up there. Oh, this could be quite funny. Now, if we thought the cub's dismount was ungraceful, Mom's could even be more so. Uh-oh. Isn't that beautiful? Hope you guys are getting some fantastic screenshots. She's coming down. Oh, that wasn't too bad. So it's not unusual to find lion cubs climbing into trees and that, but it is relatively unusual to see adults in this part of the world. Now, it's not that they're not capable of climbing. They are, they're just not very good at it. Now, those cubs are wandering off again. I don't know where the rest of the pride is. Sorry, I'm just listening. Ooh. So the cubs are disappearing off down there. I have to wonder whether the pride has abandoned the buffalo and is on the move again. We're just going to see what's happening. I saw a bit of movement in front of the cubs. Let's just go forward a bit and see. Oh, you know what could have also happened, we'll have to check on that just now, is that, as I said, three Birmingham boys are very close. The fourth was just over there. Now, it is possible that the Birminghams might have chased them off the kill. I just heard it. Sounds like some ellies around as well. Or maybe elephants have chased them. So far we've only got one lioness and two cubs. Try to stick with them. Okay, so while we try to figure out what's going on with these lions, let's go see how Jamie's leopard tracking is faring.
I hate to say that my leopard tracking is not going terribly well. And in fact, the tracks have completely vanished from being the most beautiful tracks to disappearing completely. I think I might have picked the wrong direction, but I do just want to trek along a treehouse dam road right the way towards a waterhole, because it's one of Karula's favourite spots, and she's actually had quite a few kills along this road. So I'm checking along here, stopping every now and again to check these mud wallows, like the one over here. I doubt she would have come for a drink here, though. The water now is not really so much water as just mud, kind of like what you saw the hippo covered in a little bit earlier with Brent. I don't think she's walked along here. I don't think she's far, though. And I've been walking around and just listening really, really carefully for the sound of crunching, because I think it's probably safe to assume that my guess about her having a kill is correct. And now it's just a question of finding where it is. And often we found leopards just by listening to the sound, either alarm calls in the bush or the sound of them feeding on the carcass and the crunching of the bones. But she might be tired and she might not be feeding right now. And the little one's teeth are not yet strong enough to really crunch into bones. Checking the trees. I really don't want to drive past her. As I said, I might be a little rusty on looking for leopards. Luckily, I've got Brian to help me as well. She's here somewhere. She's not far. It's just the slightly damp soil that's throwing us off. We'll find her, though. We're gonna find her. I am determined. Those tracks are too beautifully clear for us not to be successful. Where have you gone, Karula? She hasn't walked along this road. Let's go and check a treehouse dam, treehouse waterhole, see if there's any water there and what's happening. You'll see me every now and again swerving off the road, and that's just because, being my height, it's not always that easy to see over the top of the Land Rover, so looking out over my right-hand shoulder is the easiest way to go about things. I wonder if she's just watched me walk past her a few times, Brian. That's entirely possible. And Lucy, you've sent through that update about... Oh, goodness. You sent through that update about the Impala alarm calling at Juma Dam. Please keep your eye on the Juma Dam camera. It could well be Tingana moving about that area. And it could also be the lion that we had there last night. Sorry, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. Brent updating everybody about the lions and where they are. So please, Lucy, keep an eye on the dam camera. It's possibly Karula, but I don't think so. I think she's somewhere here. Good morning. These tracks come north from the junction with Shabam Road. I'm just checking along Treehouse Dam Road now. There's no sign of the Nkonzo coming out this side. I think she might have gone slightly more northwest. Aubrey's on it. He's coming to come give us a hand. That's fantastic news, because he has got William, his tracker, who will be able to help us as well. Now, between the sort of four of us, I'm sure we're going to manage to find her this morning. But keep an eye on the Juma Dam camera, just in case I'm incorrect. Perhaps it is Karula somewhere in that area. Could also be, I think it's probably that male lion that we had yesterday. We finished off the sunset safari with Tinyo about 200 meters from where Brent and myself live. And he didn't look like he was in the mood to move very far at all. I think it's just a termite mound, but let me double check. It is just a termite mound. Flash of red. I thought perhaps maybe an impala carcass. Got my hopes up. Alright, let's see what's happening around Treehouse Dam. I don't think... I'm sure... She's somewhere very, very close to where we were earlier. I think she's watched me walk past her. And that's the amazing thing about leopards, especially the leopards of the Sabi Sand. They are so relaxed with people on foot that sometimes they don't even really lift their heads. And with their amazing camouflage, it's very, very easy to walk. And it actually applies to all leopards, not just the leopards of the Sabi Sand. If a leopard thinks that you haven't seen them, they quite happily just stay completely still, which is wonderful, until you find yourself in relatively close proximity to one without realizing it. And there's nothing quite like the explosion of a leopard at your feet dashing off somewhere in the opposite direction. I promise you, it's positively heart-stopping. If you haven't noticed them. Where I used to work, we had two large river systems that flowed pretty much all year round, the Mkutsi and the Salati River. The Salati flows into the Kruger, into Olifants River. And it's very, obviously very, very dense vegetation. The Mwati's got nothing on a proper river. And the number of times we had a sudden surprise, whether it be a bushbuck or a leopard or something coming out of those reeds, more times than I can count. The treehouse waterhole is quiet, and I don't think there's no tracks here. Might find she would have come for a drink here, but I doubt it. Okay. She's close. She is close. It's just a matter of tracking her down. I'm going to return one more time and double-check the area where I lost those tracks. In the meantime, let's find out how Brent's morning is treating him.
So, most incredible thing happened. So, we're following that single lioness, and she went to an area we couldn't go. So, we came back. All the vultures came down onto the kill. She came rushing in. She jumped into the air, grabbed a vulture just out of sight from the camera. So, unfortunately, we couldn't catch it. It was even too quick for us. But now she's going back again. But we're not going to follow her. I think the trick is now to stay with the vultures. There she is. With the two cubs, she rushed in, she grabbed a vulture in the air, and it managed, as she hit the ground, she let it go. Now, that is only the second time in my many years in the bush that that's ever happened, and I, strange enough, just told Dave that I'd seen a lioness grab a vulture midair before. Oh, you're a pretty girl, clever girl. Oh, there's a vulture on the ground. She's rushing back towards the kill to try to chase the vultures. There's still quite a bit of meat on the kill. I wonder where the rest of the pride are. Go catch that naughty vulture. So she's watching to make sure those vultures don't descend again. There she goes. Time not quite as close as the last one. Look at that tail flicking. She's really annoyed at those vultures. Let's just turn around quickly. And I think she should move away from the kill again, then we'll just go position ourselves on the other side and just wait. Oh, here come the little troubles. Now, where are the rest of the pride? The little one's running to join her. There she is. And this almost looks like she's wondering where the heck the rest of the pride is as well. Now, Michael's wondering, do I think something caused this pride to split? Was it possibly a Birmingham? Well, Michael, I couldn't be 100% sure. It is possible, but if it was a Birmingham, the likelihood that is that the Birmingham would be feasting on the carcass. There are just so many buffalo around and buffalo that are not well from the drought. Okay, wait, I'm going to get myself into position because there's a vulture that's already dropped down onto the carcass. And let's see if she turns around and comes back. She's coming back. Oh, I went the wrong way. Missed that little track there. There's one vulture on the ground. Is she still stalking in? I can't see. Yes. Okay, we're just going to position ourselves. We don't want to get too close that the vultures run away. Oh, no, vultures seen her and already flown away. But I think it might be worth our while just parking here for a little bit. She seems really adamant. Now, there's an overloaded tree. Okay, so let me just find the best spot for us here to see what's going on. Okay, we can see her and we can see the kill. I think this is going to be the best combination of spots. So we're just going to wait here, see if a vulture comes down. And we're not too close to the carcass, is not to scare the vultures off either. So, and there's the carcass there. Unfortunately, one errant red bush willow in the way. Who is going to be the first vulture? As off they move. So exciting. What a wonderful first time back with the incredible Nkuhumas after leave. Now we've got decisions to make. Do we wait it out here at the risk of losing the lions? Or do we follow the lions? Lovely vulture silhouettes there. Oh, growling. And here's some growling. I'm gonna go have a look. Maybe she's met up with the rest of the pride down there. I've lost sight of her now. I can just hear a bit of growling. Choosing an incredibly difficult area to go in. We couldn't follow them the first time. Vultures, vultures everywhere. Can you see her? Let's see if we can wait. Can't see her. She went down through here. Okay, so we're gonna keep trying to figure out where the rest of the pride are, and who knows, maybe we'll have some more lion vulture action just now, but let's go see how Jamie's leopard tracking's going.
While Brent enjoys his opportunity to catch up with the Nkuhumas, Brian and myself are returning and moving at a snail's pace back to where I last saw the leopard tracks. I just have a feeling that they really are not far from where we were. I know that Aubrey's making his way from the opposite direction, so essentially we're closing in a sort of pincer movement on where these leopards must be. The only problem is it's an incredibly dense area, which is why I'm moving so incredibly slowly and just checking up in all of the marula trees. The one thing about Karula is that she's exceptionally good at hoisting her kills. And this is the perfect area for her to have done so. In this particular spot, in fact, where was it? It was somewhere relatively close to here. It might even have been directly off to my right. There's an impala looking very comfortable. Yes, this was almost exactly where it was. This is where Brian and myself were many, many months ago when we very first saw Karula's cubs. Remember that, Brian? It was an absolutely magic sighting. We'd been sitting with her for about probably close to 45 minutes, just waiting. We knew the cubs were there, and we just waited. And she started right at the end, just as I was about to leave. She started calling them out, that chirping, almost croaking-like sound. And these two little bundles of fur came running out. It was absolutely... It's truly one of the most magic moments we've ever had on Safari Live. I don't know how you feel, Brian, but it was when the little one, and I don't even know which one it was now, climbed up into the tree with Mom, and she was giving it a little bath and stopped and looked at us. They were this big, just tiny little fuzzballs. That was absolutely, truly spectacular. And of course then, everything was so uncertain. They were just so tiny and vulnerable. And of course, with the tragic news of Tundi's little cub, she did lose one of her cubs while I was on leave, which I'm devastated about, having seen them go through that whole moment with those baboons chasing them. Everything about Karula's cub's future is so insecure at that point. And to have seen them grow up and to have seen Karula look after them in the way that she has been truly special. It's the first time I've ever seen, obviously, it's the first time I've ever seen Karula raise cubs. And I understand so much better what everybody was always saying about her being a very gifted mother in the way that she raises her cubs. She's just so good at it. Now, where is she? Having said that, Karula, I'm singing your praises. A little bit of flattery. Perhaps you'd like to make yourself known on that basis. We would love to see you. I'm just checking carefully. I don't think it's anything. It's like my termite mound from earlier. I'm just checking in the marula trees. Come on, little cubs. No. Nothing there. I thought I saw movement, but it could even have been a bird. Okay, it's making me feel slightly better in that I don't think I drove past her the first time I did this road at the start of the sunrise safari. Just wish I knew which side of the road she's on. I did not pick up one toe of a leopard crossing the road on Treehouse Dam, which suggests to me that they're actually on this side of the road. And the wonderful thing, of course, about those magical moments with Karula and her cubs is that those moments are recorded in history forever. That's the joy of these live safaris. It's not like guests saw her for the first time and it was, you know, it would be very special for them and they would have had photographs. But for us, we've got those records forever. Will always, always be something that we will remember. And Brian and myself especially. It was the first time we'd seen them. Excitement was running high. I think Brent had seen them first thing that morning. Oh, it was very special. I almost wish I could go back in time to those moments. Right. And so we find ourselves back where we started. Did I walk past her? Was I right next to her the whole time? I've been out on foot checking all of the sort of muddy water holes around those areas. I can see where she came out. And she popped out here, so I think she's made a kill somewhere in here. Right, while I search for whatever hapless animal Karula happened to catch, and of course Karula and her cubs, let's go across to Brent, who has got the poor hapless buffalo that the Nkuhumas caught.
So we're back at the buffalo carcass. We couldn't find those lions and some really thick stuff. Now, it seems like the vultures aren't quite as brave as they were a few minutes ago. Now, what we want is all of them to descend on the carcass, start squabbling, and that'll attract the lions back. But I think they're a bit nervous now, so what we're going to do is we're going to do a little loop and see what's happening there and give the vultures a little chance to settle. And I think they're just a little nervous after we were here. But hopefully the sound of them squabbling over the buffalo will bring the rest of the pride, or even just that single lioness, rushing back. Now, she went off in a sort of westerly direction, so we'll just do a little bumble around, see if we maybe don't spot the rest of the pride around Central Road. Dave, well, Ariel has fallen down. Oh, We only saw a single lioness and two cubs. Now, Nicole in Canada is wondering, is that odd? Not necessarily. It's not that uncommon for the pride to be split from time to time. She might have gone off with those cubs to get a drink, and the pride might have moved somewhere else. But they should find each other without too much difficulty. I'll use those low contact calls. Oh. 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 As I say, there's so much opportunity for the lions at the moment that they might have just abandoned that carcass. And as we've been saying, the lions have been so successful at the moment. Fran saying she wouldn't be surprised if the other lions had made a second kill. And she just can't decide which one she wants to eat. It is, of course, a very possible fan. Okay, so last time we saw her, she was heading into the thickets this way. Just have a quick little loop, give the vultures a chance to settle onto the ground. Just looking out for tracks, make sure they haven't crossed the road. Now, lots of different animals will alarm at big cats, and Aaron's wondering, will birds of prey? Not generally. They tend to recognize another apex predator, so they don't normally alarm at the other birds or the other big cats. It also just depends, so vultures and basilares and things like that will actively seek them out. But it's always possible if it's on the alarm calling, not so much. Okay, very, very thick area. Oh, very interesting news now. I wonder who that could be. So apparently down in Coral, so outside of our Travis area, there's a pack of wild dogs, 8 adults, 6 babies. Fingers crossed they come this way. Okay, no signs of the lions coming across here. Now, this area in here is a myriad of little river systems and thickets, and quite difficult to get a vehicle through. But I just want to check, there's one nice little open patch up ahead here I'm going to have a quick look at. Remember, this is a live African safari, and you can ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Okay, so definitely didn't come this way, because there are some relaxed looking antelopes. Hello, Nyalas. Which means the lions are probably further to the north. Here we go, and there's a male Nyala. I'm just also stopping to listen to see if we can hear those contact calls from the lions. Oop. I also think we've given the vultures ample time to settle. So I'm going to meander back towards that buffalo carcass. Oh, full of the joy of morning. I'm trying to look into the distance, see if those trees are still littered with vultures, or if they're descended to pick up the litter and do their job as the waste disposal unit. able to eat some of the most putrid flesh around. Now, as I said, that lioness jumped and grabbed a vulture out of the air, and Kitty Kitty Bang Bang would like to know, would she have eaten it? Would she have plucked it? Unlikely. Even in that other case where I saw that lioness catch and kill a vulture, she just left it. Probably quite. Yeah, they are full of lots of nasty things, mites and flukes and tapeworms and all the like. But if for some reason you'll often find that unless really, really pressed for food, they won't eat something like a vulture or a hyena or another lion. Now, to say that they won't ever would be an absolute lie, because you never know what's going to happen. Hello. There's some alleys. Now, I think that could easily be what split and chased all the lions off the carcass. A herd of elephants coming through. And we've seen how much the elephants are not fan of having the big cats around. Having an early morning dust bath. And little ones having a drink. Thirsty little tyke. Looks like a little boy. Well, everything seems to be in the thickets today. It's amazing how a massive animal like that can disappear. There's a little one going to come out. Look at that. Here we go. Coming out into the open slowly. Hi guys. The game viewing is just so spectacular at the moment. Oh, we can hear that. Talking eddies. They are just too cute for words. Look at these giving mom kisses. Not feeding, but sort of just playing with mom. Small herd. You can see 4 or 5 individuals through the thickets. I am hoping that come out into the open close to us, especially with that little baby. There we go. Come this way. I must be enjoying the new flush on the leaves. Oh, listen, 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 lions. Hear the lions. Now Stephanie was wondering, are lions afraid of elephants? Most definitely. Elephants are the true kings and queens of the bush, just based on size. There we go. And the little guys are just too wonderful. There we go. Hello, peeking out. Don't be shy. I think if we sit patiently, the herd looks like it's coming towards us. So I'm just going to wait here. See what the Ellies get up to. Now all that beep 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 is just Dave turning on the VR rig in case the elephants do pass very close to us. Now they'll be a lot more happy that there's been a bit of rain. A bit of flash on the leaves, flash on the grass. Love that wrinkled skin on the elephant. Oh, and baby's gone off to play with the others, but let's see, here's mom. Oh, no, I don't think it's mom. I think it's maybe an aunt or an older sister. Doesn't look like her teats are swollen enough to be lactating. Not going to come towards us. Right, so we're going to leave these Ellies. I think they're going to avoid us. And let's go back and check where I could hear those lions calling. Sounded close to the carcass. While we do that, let's go see how Jamie's hunt for Queen Karula is going.
Right, so we've moved our leopard search slightly further afield onto Philemon's cutline just to double check and see whether or not she didn't pop out in this general direction. Aubrey's at Treehouse Dam. He's double checking the area to make sure I didn't miss anything. And now it's just a question of trundling along this road and checking for tracks. The interesting thing that I've noticed is since I've been back, there have been lots and lots of general game animals. So zebra and impala and kudu, waterbuck. And in this particular area, there are hardly any. It makes me wonder whether or not that's just still a throwback to when the wild dogs were moving through this particular area. Brian, you were with Brent yesterday, yeah, around this particular spot. Yeah. Because there's absolutely... I mean, things like waterbuck and wildebeest and zebra, they're big enough generally to fight back and to scare away wild dogs. But for the most part, you do notice that the general game, when a pack of wild dogs move through an area, they tend to scatter off for a while and not necessarily return. There have been a couple of impala, but that's pretty much it. And one or two very large animals that walked on top of my leopard tracks, that's actually what's made life relatively difficult. This is half the fun, though. This is the fun part. Working hard and trying to track down something is always an incredibly enjoyable way to spend a morning. Even when you're not successful, although I still think we're going to be successful, but even when you're not successful, the challenge of trying to figure it out, trying to put yourself into the mind of that animal and figure out exactly where they've gone. As you know, putting yourself into Karula's mind is a tricky one because she doesn't have a set direction. She moves at 90 degree angles many times, sometimes a 180, full 180, walks back on herself. She's incredibly difficult to predict except when she has cubs and when she's leading cubs to something. I'm almost certain that she's somewhere in this area. Now, one of the things, and of course you've seen it with Brent, and one of the things that we've noticed a lot of is there are quite a few buffalo carcasses lying around. And I just had a jolly good sniff because I thought I smelt something. And Bill, you were wondering whether or not Karula would take her cubs to a dead buffalo carcass, or would she be concerned about the lions? And that's a tricky question because Karula's always shown a great sense in terms of keeping herself and her cubs alive and out of danger. As many of you will know, leopards are scavengers. They can absolutely scavenge. We've seen Karula feeding off a dead buffalo before with Tingano when she was mating with him. We've seen Shimbambalana feeding off a buffalo carcass that died on Cheetah Plains. Now, absolutely, she would go and scavenge off it, but would she take her cubs there? And my suggestion is probably not. Although, that being said, the cubs are getting old enough now, and we've seen it many times before, where they actually kind of know how to look after themselves. Their tree climbing skills are almost as good as an adult leopard. They might not have the strength, but they certainly have the nimbleness and balance of an adult leopard. We've seen them shoot right up into the top of trees to escape wild dogs and baboons. And perhaps Hosanna has... They're definitely better than the lions are at climbing trees. That's absolutely true. We've seen Hosanna once or twice get a little bit too brave and a little bit too confident, but Karula knows the cubs can look after herself. Now, the answer to your question is that I don't really know. It's unpredictable, but my guess would be no. Karula would keep them away from a big carcass like that. Just for her, probably not worth the risk. And it's not so much hyenas, it's lions. Lions will be the biggest risk to her and her cubs. They can climb trees, albeit, as you saw with Brent, not necessarily particularly gracefully, and sometimes their dismounts leave a lot to be desired. Come on, Royal Queen. Your Highness, I appear to have missed my appointment, and now I can't find you. And I know I missed that. I know I missed her by maybe just an hour or two, judging from those tracks. And I think, judging by the... There's lots of Dacre in this area. There's also lots and lots of Impala. She seems to be an expert at the moment at catching Impala. And one of the... Of course, this is a boon for the predators. Apart from the drought, which, as we know, and we've discussed at length, has been incredibly positive for our predator population. Apart from that, the Impala ewes, most of them are pregnant. And that's basically like getting two for the price of one. The Impala ewes are slowed down, their reflexes aren't quite as fast, they're heavy, and they don't quite have the stamina that they would normally. And as a result, it does mean that for things like leopards, it is an additional source of protein. Now we just have to find this carcass, which has got to be somewhere in this vicinity. It's got to be somewhere here. She walked a direct line down the road, fetched the cubs, and walked straight back up. And then a couple of large elephants walked on top of her tracks. On the subject of birthing Impala, and of course that is imminent, we're going to start seeing new lambs any day now. Michael, you wanted to know, how would the predators know when the ewes start to give birth, or is it just by stumbling upon them? And the answer is, it's pretty much just by stumbling upon them. They go about their hunting as normal, and let's stop and have a look since we are talking about Impala. We've got one ewe here that is, I don't know if she's pregnant, it's hard to tell, she doesn't look particularly pregnant. But it'll be by stumbling across them. And yes, certainly, I think they could smell if an animal has given birth. You know, she is pregnant. Staring off into the distance. She spotted something, but it's not the sort of frantic attention level that Impala show when they've seen a leopard or a lion or another predator. It's just double-checking to see what she's seen. It could even be other Impala that she's looking at. But let's just settle for a moment and watch her. See if she does start to alarm call, because their eyesight is unbelievably sharp. Hello. What have you seen? You have to feel for Impala ewes. They spend either some of their year being pregnant, heavily pregnant, then they spend it trying to raise lambs and trying to keep them safe from predators, or then they're being chased around by the rams ready to mate again, and that's pretty much the year of an Impala ewe, running away from males or running away from predators. And I think that we're going to find that with this drought, it's going to take a serious toll on the new mothers, whether or not they actually manage to carry the pregnancy to full term. I suspect we're going to see far less in terms of pregnancies and Impala lambs wandering about. They'll be there, though. Impala are resilient creatures. What is there, my girl? What have you seen? Last night was cloudy, it was windy, it was perfect hunting weather for a leopard like Karula. The Now, Michael, I would say that it's just by stumbling upon these animals that the predators realize that they're pregnant. But who knows exactly what the animals know instinctively? Is it just capitalizing on distraction, or do they actually actively target them because they know they're going to be pregnant? I don't think it's actively targeting. I think it's just pure hunting instinct. And sometimes it pays off in terms of a pregnant ewe or a newborn lamb. And the lambs are such easy targets. Wobbly on their legs, they haven't quite got the coordination yet, and they don't have the same level of alertness that the surviving adults do. You don't make it to adulthood as an impala unless you're exceptionally alert. And Bourbon Street on a periscope. You're watching our live safari and you say that this impala looks healthy. She does. She's a little bit thin, although it's hard to tell because, of course, she's got that pregnancy weighing down in her belly, so it's pulling her stomach down slightly. Her hip bones are a little bit prominent. But other than that, it's just goes to show just how successful impala truly are. And one of the big reasons, one of the big keys to their success is the fact that their diet and their digestive systems are so incredibly varied and variable. So they can nibble off leaves, they can nibble off grass. All right, I'm listening half with half an ear to the game drive comms. Aubrey's just chatting about those leopard tracks we've been following. Just bear with me 1 second. Aubrey's gonna come and help us out. He's just arrived where the tracks cross. All of us looking. Taxon's on his way now as well. But yes, for the most part, the impala have weathered the drought relatively well. And Bree, on the subject of antelope, you want to know what my favorite antelope is. Sure, it's a difficult one. I've always struggled with the question of what's your favorite anything. What is your favorite predator? What is your favorite? Well, I know my favorite predator, but what is your favorite antelope? I really enjoy seeing sable. It's not something that I've ever seen on these live drives before. There was one seen for the first time in 17 years on the Juma Dam camera not too long ago. So that's one of my favorites. Gemsbok, or the oryx, I also find truly spectacular. You won't find them here. They're much more arid-based antelope, so towards the deserts. And when I used to work in the Kalahari, I was always truly astounded and impressed by the strength of those animals. They are truly spectacular creatures. Good morning. So gemsbok, I quite like steenbok as well. Oh, it's a difficult question. Here's a little dwarf mongoose sunning itself as it starts to warm up. I'm also getting warm, little mongoose. An early riser, it seems. The rest of the family is still hidden away in their termite mound burrow. This little one's just popped up to sunbathe in the morning light. Getting an idea of the morning, looking about for any breakfast. And Fran, absolutely, while we watch this little mongoose sun itself and glance backwards and forwards, constantly on alert, you're absolutely right. The light is beautiful. The air feels clean. The sun is shining through the bright green leaves. It really is absolutely beautiful. And I think my favorite time of all the times to be out in the bush, there I can actually choose a favorite here, is first thing in the morning on a summer's morning. There is nothing quite like this atmosphere and the fresh smell. I wonder if the mongoose enjoy it every time they wake up and they spend that first hour. And there we go, we're doing all sorts of favorites. Bree, you want to know if our favorite drive is a sunrise or sunset. For me, hands down, my favorite is sunrise. I love being up in the morning, first thing before the sun rises, being up with the sunrise, hearing the birds, and unrolling or unwrapping the mysteries of the evening, whatever's happened at night. That is hands down my favorite. Brian, what do you think? Sunset or sunrise?
Sunrise.
Sunrise. Yeah. Yeah, and I know that Brent, I'm pretty sure that Brent agrees with me. He's also a sunrise person. Not that there's anything wrong with the sunset. That mongoose looked at us so accusingly there. Now, for our newer viewers, this is a dwarf mongoose, the smallest of the mongoose family, and one of my absolute favourite animals to sit and spend time with when you can. We don't always have that luxury, but when we can, they can be fascinating little creatures. And you can see this one's the early riser of the group. First awake. And obviously, because they are so small, even in a summer evening, the chill actually takes hold and they have to spend at least the first half an hour of their morning sunbathing. And you'll find that with lots of the mongoose family, including the meerkats, or the Surrey cats of the desert, of the Kalahari. They will also spend their first, and I know that Brian spent a long time following them, and they always do it, don't they, Brian?
Yeah.
That first thing in the morning sunbathing session, grooming, reaffirming their bonds before they go off for their day and go about their daily business. And of course, in the desert, temperatures, even in summer, but especially in winter, can drop below freezing during the night. Little animals have to huddle together for warmth and then sunbathe to get themselves moving and to sort of release their joints and their muscles. What's up, little one? Must be scary being that size in the bush. There's so much out here to catch them. And Nut One, you say he's catching a tan. Absolutely, although I think he's got a pretty good tan going already with that rich dark brown colour. Very important to remember, if you ever come and visit South Africa or any parts of Africa during summer, lots and lots of sunblock on the subject of tanning. I'm pretty sure I'm going to turn into leather in the next 10 years or so, despite copious amounts of sunblock. The sun is incredibly strong. But yes, you can just imagine this little mongoose first thing in the morning, sunglasses on, little hat, leaning back, reclining on the termite mound. It's the perfect spot. Got a nice vantage point. A safety hole to dash back into if they need to. Now, Andrew, you want to know, while we watch our mongoose family wake up, and I'm just wondering if there aren't any on the other side of the termite mound. I don't think so, though. I think this is just an early riser. The early mongoose catches the scorpion, so to speak. And you want to know if they're more active during the day or in the evening. The day. So they actually can be quite late risers, especially in winter. They sometimes only pop out at around 9 o'clock in the morning. And you usually find as soon as the sun starts to dip towards the horizon, they are back grooming each other, back clustered around their termite mound burrows or whatever holes they happen to live in at the particular time, because they do move from place to place. But absolutely, they are strictly diurnal. You will never see a dwarf mongoose out at night or even in the evening as it starts to get dark. They spend the height of the day, even in the heat, because they're so small. They don't have to worry too much about getting too hot. They can spend most of their day foraging for insects. That is in complete contrast, of course, to their much larger cousin, the white-tailed mongoose. And we spent a considerable... There's a white-tailed mongoose den somewhere not far from here. And when we were doing the long evening drives right up until 10:30 at night, we spent about, I would say, a good hour, close to an hour, with the white-tailed mongoose in this area, in the pitch blackness. So a completely different approach. Water mongoose and white-tailed mongoose, or nocturnal species of mongoose. The rest of them are diurnal. The slenders, the dwarf, and the banded mongoose. The banded mongoose we hardly ever get to see. Aren't they cute? They're such fascinating little creatures. And I sometimes wish that we had the time or the ability to just spend time with one particular family of mongoose and get to know which of them is the alpha breeding pair. Because, of course, much like the wild dogs that we were talking about earlier, only the alpha male and the female will breed. The rest of the family is devoted to helping to look after their young. Look at those fierce claws. You can actually see just how long they are. And that immediately tells you what this little creature is. It's the smallest of the carnivores, or the mammalian carnivores, on Juma and in the Sabi sand. Frantically digging through the sand to catch an expert diggers. in terms of digging up grubs and scorpions. Ah, look at that. That's beautiful. I hope you're getting lots of amazing screenshots. You can even see its nose moving as it breathes and it sniffs the air. So while our little mongoose thinks about getting going for the day, it seems as though Brent's scavengers are wide awake and ready to face the morning. Let's go and have a look at some vultures.
We've made our way back to that buffalo carcass. You can see all the vultures on the ground. I think the lions might have now finally abandoned it completely. Tucking in. Here you can see those. Oh, little argument. Ah, there's no. Inside a carcass. Can we hear that, Dan? Mm. So you can hear that sort of high-pitched whining. And it also looks like the vultures these days are so well fed that there's not that much competition around the carcass. Lots of them just sitting around, watching, preening the one at the back. Now that's all the white-backed vultures involved in that. I keep hoping to see those lions come rushing back, but no such luck. Oh, quickly, 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 that one flying there, that's a rare vulture. Oh, don't disappear, don't disappear. It's going there, it's a white-headed vulture. I didn't see them earlier. Nice camera work, Dave. That's one of the rarer vulture species we get. There's only about 11 or 13 breeding pairs in the whole Greater Kruger. Now, has it spotted the Inkahumas? Oh, beautiful. On another kill. And down behind the trees it goes. But that's one of the rarer vulture species. So that's really exciting. We don't get to see them too often. Might be a new tick for a few of you bird lists. But it doesn't look like too much else is happening here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to loop around the block, see if the lions pop out on the other side. Who knows, maybe the Nkumas have made another kill. But it is turning out to be a glorious morning. You can see that sun breaking through. Is wondering what is the biggest vulture species that we get here in Juma Private Game Reserve. That would be the lappet-faced vulture. I'll find a picture of them for you just now. Okay, Dave, you see what I'm looking at? Okay, so I zoom a little bit to the left. Have I got lost? Okay, wait. Come back. Oh, no, straight zoom, 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 zoom. Up a bit. Oh, there he went. Looked like an African cuckoo. Didn't get a good enough view. Could be a European cuckoo. Very difficult to tell the difference till you can get a close look. Oh, there are lion tracks up, down, and all around here. But I think that's them going off to have a drink at Quarry Pan. What a fantastic morning so far, and hopefully Jamie has some luck with her leopard hunting, but we've found another creature in the meantime. Hello, Ellie. Let's just try to get into a spot. Oh, I think all the Ellie's seem to be going into the thickets today. It's a young bull. Are you the one who chased the lions off the buffalo kill, I wonder? Are you coming this way? Oh, how convenient. He's turned around. Let's see if we can find a window through the bush. Let's try through here. Oh, a bit thick. How's that, Dave? There we go, young elephant bull. Eating his breakfast. Here we go. What do you find down there? So eating some of the small little plants that have shot through since the rain. Lovely morning light at the moment. Farmer John is wondering, what is our average rainfall in this part of the part of Africa at this time of the year? Well, our rainy season generally extends from now November through to April. And oh, lion again. Did you hear that, Dave? These lions are around here somewhere. Sorry, Farmer John, I just want to see if line sounded like it was right behind us. But so about 350 mils a year, and the drought was so bad, to give you an example. Now that is over our rainy season, which falls in two parts of the year. Of course it falls in from November through to April, and last year we only got about 125, so less than half of our annual rainfall. This year, I'm not sure how much we've had so far, but we're probably on par for a normal rain cycle this year. Okay, those lions are around here somewhere. Now, Tracy's wondering, are there any animals that are not harmed by a water drought? Indeed, Tracy, the lions, the leopards, the hyenas, all your predatory species, they like a water drought because it makes life more difficult for the buffalo and other creatures. Well, Ellie will come back, so I just want to stop up here and listen again. And as you've seen, the Nkuhumas have done incredibly well over this drought period. Where is that lion now? They're all looking for each other, so there's a good chance they were split by elephants. Looks like that elephant might come out into the road. Hi, big guy. Where are you off to? You might be heading towards the mud wallow at Quarry Pan. I think let's try and beat him there. And also give us a chance to listen for the lions again. Callie's wondering, how do the pans get their names? Well, a lot of them have been named a long, long time ago. But Gwarry Pan is called Gwarry Pan because it's on Gwarry Road or Gwarry Pan Road. So there are a lot of Gwarry bushes on that particular stretch of the reserve. So named after the trees that are close by. It doesn't look like he's going to the Pan, he's going east. He's going to stalk up on Dave. Hey, big boy. Doesn't like you, Dave. It's giving Dave the evil eye. Now, that's very common behavior with an elephant bull. When he walks past you, just to lift his head a little bit, open up those ears, just saying, listen, I'm a big guy. You don't want to mess with me. Now, there are lion tracks here again. Let's see if these are on top of my tracks from earlier this morning. Doesn't look like it. Let's go have a look. Maybe the lions are thirsty. No sign of any lions. So let's go back. One last check at the vultures. And then I think we're going to leave the area. Oh, here comes the sun. A big Safari Live welcome to SRT, who's watching on Periscope and is wondering, is this really live or was it pre-recorded? No, this is live. I'm chatting to you from the middle of the African bush. I'm in the beautiful Juma Private Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands within the Greater Kruger in the northeastern part of one of the most beautiful and spectacular countries in the world, sunny South Africa. Now, there are some lions around here. I've heard them calling a little bit. We saw a female with two cubs a bit earlier. What I think's happened is they've been chased by elephants, so they've been split up, and they're now trying to find each other. Now, they'd had a buffalo kill here, and they seem to have abandoned it to the vultures. Here we go. We're arriving back at the kill site. No sign of a lion. So I think those elephants have really split them up. There's just vultures aplenty all around doing their job, making sure there's no rotting carrion left. But even the vultures are looking quite full because a lot of them are just sitting next to the carcass, not even feeding. Yeah, that one's perched atop the retired buffalo. You can see all the flies buzzing around. Of course, inside a carcass as old as this, there's going to be lots of maggots, carrion beetles. Now, a lot of you are wondering, why aren't there any hyenas here? Well, our hyena clan seems to have moved a little bit further to the north, so we haven't been seeing as many hyenas, but that could always change. There's also, because coming out of the drought, there's some not so well buffalo. There's just so many carcasses everywhere that there's not that much competition for food amongst the predators and scavengers. Different noises the vultures make. Now, if we've got any movie buffs out there, the velociraptors in the original Jurassic Park. Their noises were different vultures' noises, slowed down and sped up. So Tyrannosaurus Rex was an elephant, and the vultures were velociraptors. Heard a lion call again, but I think that one was my imagination. And there's some vultures sunning themselves, doing a bit of preening, getting some of that decaying carcass off themselves. Now they have incredible immune systems. They are immune to a lot of diseases that would wipe out other things, such as anthrax, for example. Now, you can hear something that it sounds like heavy footsteps. It's actually the vultures pecking at that carcass. Oh, look at those flies. Oh, that was my piece of meat. Not too serious. Now, if there was a bit more pressure for food, you'll often find these vulture squabbles can be far, far more serious than this. And they often will keep checking to make sure there's no lion rushing in to chase them off. Everything has its place out here in the bush. And here we're sitting with the disposal crew, the cleanup crew. Now, of course, they don't work alone. As I said, lots of maggots and carrion beetles. Well, Breviary would like to know what vulture is the dead of their own kind. Possibly, it's unusual, but they might if there's an expired vulture on the ground somewhere. Oof, that was a bit more serious a fight there. Incoming! Da-dun, da-dun, da-dun. Da-dun, da-dun, da-dun. There's a bit of vulture bullying going on. I'm too full to eat, but I don't really want anyone else to, so I'm gonna chase them. Oh, look at that vulture lying down on the ground behind. There we go, yes. Well, there's another one doing the same thing. So, sunning itself, opening it up its wings, resting. Looks quite comfortable, like he's sitting in an armchair. I think let's leave the vultures to their breakfast and carry on with our endeavors, see what else we can find. Remember, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or pop us an email, questions@wildearth.tv, if you want to ask us any questions. Now, Jamie's been looking for Queen Karula and the cubs, so let's go see how her endeavors have been faring.
Well, so far the endeavours, unfortunately, are unsuccessful, but guess where we are? Back at a treehouse dam and treehouse waterhole, or about to be. Still think it's definitely one of Karula's favourite spots, and we know that she's in the vicinity. Tax has arrived as well, with his tracker, Fanuti. So between the now, what's that, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of us, one of us has got to find her at some point. She's here somewhere. Oh, cute. I wonder if it's going to stay now that it's realized it's been seen. I wonder if I can get a position where we can see it. Aww. Oh, there's two of them. A pair of sleeping Dacre. And obviously been spending their morning tucked up, much like the dwarf mongoose. They've been little late risers this morning. Hidden in their perfect spot. And that's, of course, how little antelopes sleep. Tucked together in their monogamous pairs, right up against something like a fallen tree or a thick, dense bush. Somewhere that they can feel slightly safe and protected while they doze. Unlike the impala, they don't have the protection of the herd, just each other. And they live together in a male-female pair in their tiny little territories, essentially spending most of their days separate from each other, marking their territorial boundaries, feeding, browsing, digging up whatever they can find to eat, and then they come together at the end of the evening in regular little sleeping spots where they can spend the night in relative security. But as I said, they've only got each other, and they don't have the advantage of safety in numbers. Hence why you will never, ever find a Dacre sleeping out in an open area like quarantine, which is, of course, what a lot of our antelope do. Wildebeest, even zebra, impala. On a night like last night, where the clouds are covering the moon, there's no ambient light at all, it's dark, it's windy, you'll find the herd animals go and sleep out in the clearings, in the open areas, because lots of eyes means lots of security. It doesn't work that way with the Dacre. They've got to take care of themselves. Steenbok, exactly the same principle. And slowly but surely, the animals of Juma are waking up. Right, I think this is... Now, I can't remember. I have checked this road already, but we're going to check it again. We're going to see what we have missed. Because I know that she's here somewhere. It'll be worth it once we find her, promise. And find her we shall. And Bree, you wanted to know what the hardest animal to track is. And the answer to that, sorry, I just want to see what that roller's doing. I think it's got a nest in that dead tree there. Let's just have a closer look. Sorry, I'll get back to that question in a moment. Yep, definitely. That lilac-breasted roller has got a nest in that dead tree, in the hollow there. I don't know whether it's excavating or it's feeding. It's definitely feeding chicks. You can see the way it's hovering and sticking its bill in regularly. It's obviously got little ones in there. And there we go, there's one and two, mom and dad, keeping the little ones fed and healthy. The perfect spot to hide your chicks in a hollowed out dead tree, holes made by borer beetles and termites and other such insects make for a perfect secure spot. Of course, one of the only things that will be a threat to these lilac-breasted roller chicks would be something like a harrier hawk or maybe a snake or something similar. Remember, if you cast your mind back, those of you who've been regular viewers for many years, if you cast your memories back to about a year ago when Scott found that lilac-breasted roller nest in a marula tree, and that one was low enough that we were actually able to have a look inside, and we learned a great deal about the fledging time of lilac-breasted rollers. If I try and remember the numbers off the top of my head, it's something like 19 days incubation and 34 days to fledging, from when the chicks hatch to when they have their feathers. And we were able to actually monitor that particular nest. And I've been keeping an eye out to see whether or not they've returned to that particular marula tree. Haven't seen any sign of them yet. But it is a bird that will return and use the same nest sites year after year. I was looking at, while we were on leave, we were with friends of ours with a very small child, and she only speaks French. We were doing all of the different, we were scrolling through photos on Brent's phone and doing the animals, and doing, it was wild dog, wild dog, wild dog, wild dog, going through the pictures that Brent had. There's some thick knees, sorry. I'm just going to see if they're going to pop. Oh, they're racing away. That's a nocturnal bird species. Look like spotted thick knees. Sorry, I'll finish the story in a moment about the little girl who's too gorgeous for words. A thick knee. Swishing its tail. Also used to be known as a dikkop, or a thick head. Nocturnal birds with wide eyes. We hardly ever get to see them during the day, so it's lovely to see them. We've obviously disturbed them slightly. There we go. Hold on, everybody. Sorry, I need to chat on the game drive comms. Are you calling me, Orbs? Negative. I can't work out where they've gone from those mud wallows. They haven't crossed Philemon's cut line, and it doesn't look like they've come along Scavenger's track either. Okay, copy. I'm sure they're not far. Maybe in that Skorva that runs off Treehouse Dam, somewhere around there. The last track I had was just by that mud wallow. Morning. Good, thanks. How are you? Sorry to block your way. We've just been watching the rollers. Cool. Yeah, we're going to see Krula's tracks come into this area, so she's somewhere here. You can keep your eyes peeled. Cool. Okay. Cool. It's lovely to have you driving around.
Yes.
Cool. Enjoy. I'll let you know if we have any luck with the... Cool. Okie dokie. Cheers. Hi. What was I talking about? Oh, yes, the lilac-breasted roller. Anyway, so we're going through, and yes, it was the little girl. A little girl of friends of ours. She's six, but as I said, she only speaks French, but she knows, obviously, a few English words and the names of animals. And we got to the lilac-breasted roller, and she went... Bird. And we went, yes, okay. And she started doing the colors. And obviously it was blue and green, and then it was white, and then pink. And then she started with, and I mean, it was just so incredibly appropriate, mauve and indigo and scarlet. And she started getting incredibly specific with the colors. I was so incredibly impressed, considering this girl only speaks French. Her grasp of colours was truly well developed. I think perhaps she's got a future somewhere in the art world, because I'm pretty sure that I didn't realise all of the different nuances of the various colours when I was that age, and especially not in my second language. I was most impressed with her. It was too sweet. Leopard, leopard, leopard. And Karen, yes, absolutely. The lilac-breasted rollers are probably one of the most beautiful birds that we get out here. My favorite are the bright green cuckoos, the Deirdrecks and the Classes cuckoo, but absolutely they are. The lilac-breasted rollers are truly striking birds. And you can see why as a child, because there are lots, you know what Brent's photographs are like. He's got some amazing ones. But you can see why for a child, the lilac-breasted roller was the one that most attracted her attention. Cheetah? 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 So cute. And it always astounds me the way that small children these days know exactly how to use a touchscreen and to swipe and which way to swipe and how to swipe in a direction and how to zoom in and how to zoom out. I was quite astounded at the grasp of technology. I've never failed to be surprised. And Elizabeth, you want to know whether or not lilac-breasted rollers are monogamous as well. Yes, they are. They are not necessarily life partners, though. So unlike the Wahlberg's eagles, for example, that will separate when they migrate and then come back together each and every year to breed, lilac-breasted rollers can form different pairs. But for the season, they're basically seasonal monogamists. For that breeding season, they will mate with each other and mate for life. And you'll find that actually around, I think the percentage is somewhere around 90% of all of the birds that we see out here, from the hornbills that I'm going to try and show you in a moment, from the hornbills to the raptors to all sorts of birds, you'll find that they are monogamous in some way, whether it is seasonal or whether it is for life. I think it's about 90%. There's very few exceptions to it. The jacanas, of course, are one such exception, has this hornbill duct. Yeah, this hornbill is playing hard to get. Luckily, Brian's... Oh! Oh! Well, we tried. There's a grey hornbill. I'm I'm going to go trundle along, meet up with Aubrey and Taxon and discuss our plans from there. And while we do that, let's head back across to Brent for an update on his side.
So, Dave and I have decided to meander down the Mawati. Who knows, maybe Queen Karula's come this way, and maybe we'll find the ever-elusive white-throated robin. And this is heating up, so could find quite a few animals seeking solace from the sun in the shade around the Mawati River. And of course, always lovely birds, but there's a very pretty little bird, the emerald-spotted wood dove. And I love the way the doves walk, specifically the wood doves. They don't ever seem to have a pan. They sort of, oh, and there's a flower. We'll come back to that. That's not moving. They sort of zigzag. They don't ever walk in a straight line. And when you find their tracks on the road, they're all over the place. I love the way their head also constantly flicking away, looking for grass seeds, small insects. Mostly seed eaters. Oh, busy little bee. Let's go forward a little bit and let's see if we can get a bit of a closer look at that flower. There it is, a little purple flower. Oh, Dave's found a different flower. But of the same family, it looks like one of the little Ipomeas or Morning Glories. There's a little white one there. And if we come out and up the bank a little bit to the right, there we go, up a bit. There we go. There's a little blue one. Very pretty. Not too many wildflowers about just yet, but I think one more bout of rain and we should be quite inundated with them, which I'm very much looking forward to. Sorry, just need to be on the Game Drive radio for a second. Ephraim. Yeah, if that audio was around, I'd say somewhere between, I think it's Pipeline Road, First Rock. Ephraim, about 40 minutes ago. Okay, now no sign of any leopards yet. Sorry, I was just letting Ephraim know, while we were sitting with those vultures, we heard a buffalo in distress. Now I think the Birminghams might have caught another buffalo in a Torchwood. Let's have a look. Any leopard tracks here, Dave? Doesn't look like it, no. Let's keep on heading down the riverbed. Now I wonder, when the woodlands kingfisher arrives, and I also want to check for another kingfisher species that migrates, the grey hooded kingfisher, and last year they nested in a clay bank not too far from here in the Mawati River. Okay, now James, morning James, has requested one of my quizzes. Says they're always such fun. Okay, well, let's have a little think about what we're going to quiz today. A nearly impossible tree quiz? A mammal quiz? Why don't you guys let me know? What should the quiz be on this morning? Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. What should we quiz you on this morning? Now, We're in the elusive white-throated robin territory. Now, we've only managed to get it on camera once, and that was actually with Dave. And that was just down here, so I'm listening, see if we can hear him. This is such a wonderful area for bird watching, this little section of the Mowati. Wonderful big jackalberries, big timbuerti trees. Now, if we even just stop and listen, we can hear some incredible stuff. We can hear bleating warbler. We hear that coffee teal me, coffee teal me, which is the orange-breasted bushrike. Okay, Dave, are you ready to test your camera skills? Okay, so a little bit to the left, down, to the right slightly. Okay, zoom, slowly. Okay, a little bit further down. And zoom, a little bit to the right, up a bit, up. There we go, see that yellow thing? Ha-ha, a broad banded grass yellow. So you can actually see the broad black band through the yellow. So that's what that little yellow butterfly is called. I'm also very excited that butterfly season is starting again. Here we go. And the cameramen all shiver in fear when Brent starts looking for butterflies. Here we go. A broad banded grass yellow. And while we continue our Mowati River cruise, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
As we trundle along, a big welcome to any new viewers that we might have that have just jumped on board. Just a reminder that what you are watching is live and is happening right here and right now on a place called Juma Private Game Reserve. And I'm sorry, I have to listen to something in my ear quickly. I'm just chatting about the leopard that we've been searching for all morning. And she's here somewhere, we all know it, and we've got three of us rotating around the same area, desperately trying to look and see where the tracks have come out or to see if perhaps we've missed something somewhere. But that is the joy, of course, of live safaris, is that nothing is predictable, nothing is set in stone. I'm sorry, I just have to listen to this. And Texan's laughing, he's saying this is bizarre, we can't find where she's gone. Aubrey's just saying he thinks she saw me when I got out of the vehicle. I can't figure this out, there's a greater spotted cuckoo that's just flown past. I'm going to try and get it for you. When I got out earlier, I just had this constant feeling that I was being watched in some way. And I have a feeling it was her. She was looking at me. It's just a question of where she went from there. Karuda's not a nervous leopard on foot. She doesn't run away, but she will, if you're on foot, she might have moved away from me. I didn't see her though. And it's one thing to miss one leopard, that's easy to do. It's another to miss two or three. Ah, this cuckoo's gone. Lots of cuckoo activity. Just want to listen for a second. Where did she go? It's a mystery. We're all laughing at the fact that the soil's so hard that we can't actually figure out exactly which direction she went in. That's the biggest problem. I could get out and go walking in that direction, and I can get out and go walking in that direction. But I don't know which way she went. We don't know which way she went off the road. My suspicion is she's gone that way. But I don't really have any evidence to support that theory. Most frustrating. Hmm. be naughty and take a chance in here. Nothing in this side. Okay. Nothing. Let's go and have a look at the quarry. Why not? We don't have any other leads. We'll go and have a look at where they've dug sand out to cover the roads. It's also one of Karula's favorite spots. Perhaps she's popped out there. Because I'm starting to feel a little bit like I'm going crazy, driving the same roads round and round and round and round. I can see where Tex has been walking. And question coming through from JDG. You want to know how old Karula is. Now, Karula is 12 and a half. She was born somewhere around April. So she's 12 and a half now. Turning, well, I suppose you can count. Sorry, I was about to say turning 13 next year, but that kind of goes without saying. So she's 12 years old. And to have raised four litters successfully and to be on her fifth and looking very much like she's going to manage to raise this current set to adulthood as well is a tremendously impressive achievement for any leopard. It's almost actually an unprecedented record for a female leopard to have managed that. There are so many dangers and difficulties that face a female leopard raising her cubs all on her own. That the fact that Karula's been as successful as she has is remarkable. So she's raised four to adulthood, and this area is actually kind of dotted with her offspring. From Shadow to the west of us, Tundi to the east of us and south of us, Kunuma, Quarantine, Shambambalana, a lot of her offspring have stuck around in this area. Which is wonderful, because it means that viewers have been able to watch the legacy of Karula for years and years and years. Ah, it seems as though Aubrey had exactly the same idea that I did, which was to come and check this quarry. Go and investigate. Let's go right in, why not? It's a good place to hide if you're a leopard. These nice, rocky, sheltered areas. No sign of her, though. And seeing a track here is next to impossible. Let me just show you for a second. Let me show you why it's impossible. Now, I weigh probably, roughly the same amount as Karula. Maybe a little bit less, maybe a little bit more, but somewhere around the same amount. Even if I were an elephant walking along here, watch where I walk. There's not a track. There's not a sign that I've moved through this area. Now, a leopard walks with a far lighter step than I do. They've got 4 feet. And yes, maybe their weight is slightly more concentrated on a slightly smaller surface area. But if I'm walking and I'm not leaving a single sign, and I've walked along here, tracking in these sorts of spots are next to impossible. That being said, for me, with my eyes, and I think for most of us, but for those people that have devoted years and years and 10,000 hours or however long they have at tracking leopards, for them, they are actually able to see leopard tracks. I don't know how they do it. You've seen it with Herbie before, his incredible ability to see tracks in places that to me it doesn't look like anything. It doesn't even look like an indent in the soil. And yet somehow their eyes manage to pick up on it. Okay, I think it might be time to start moving our search further afield. I think we've been abandoned. I think Taxon and Aubrey have given up. I don't blame them. They've got guests on the back who want to see things. Ah, oh, Karula. Where have you vanished to? I still don't think she's gone too far. We'll go and check along Twin Dams Road, see if she didn't pop out there. I've checked all the way along Weaver's Nest, so she's not there. We were talking, actually, we had a question earlier about the hardest animal to track. What is the hardest animal to track down? And the answer to that is probably, in terms of the big animals, a leopard would be, in terms of the animals that people come on safari to really want to see, unless they're seasoned safari goers, a leopard is the most difficult. When you start learning to track, you kind of teach yourself to track and trail large animals, buffalo, rhino, elephant, creatures like that that are, it's a lot easier. In fact, on a dewy morning, on a summer morning, you can actually see the paths that they've walked where they've disturbed the dew. But a leopard walks with a feather-light tread. So they're definitely the hardest of the, and I mean, we could be facetious and say that something like a bird might be the hardest to track. But I think a leopard is probably the most difficult. Just stopping to have a look at this hole, which unfortunately it's a little bit too close to the car to fully. I'm going to try and work out what made this. Speaking of tracks and signs and so on, that is a very, very deep hole. And chances are, but why here? Why would it be digging here is the question. The chances are, with a hole like this, you're looking at something large like an aardvark. And an aardvark can easily reach 60 or so kilograms, so over 100 pounds. And they're the ones that tend to make such large holes in the soil. But what I can't work out, oh goodness, I'm smashing the antenna here. What I can't work out is why it would be digging here. I don't see any signs of termites. I don't have an aardvark nose, so I can't smell. There's an indent here that may well have been the aardvark's tail when it was digging. But the shape's just not quite right. Sometimes you do just get mysterious holes in the ground. I don't know what this was. My instinct says aardvark. Aardvark tend to dig in one direction, so when they're digging, and they're moving through, and when they're digging in an area, they tend to dig, all of the soil gets excavated in one, pretty much one direction. Whereas with something like a honey badger that's got big claws, they do this, and then they move around, and they do that, so the dirt gets spread all around. The other thing this could be, and I know that Brian was showing you earlier, was zooming into the hole earlier, with these root systems, it could be a porcupine. But that is a tremendously deep hole for a porcupine. Their diggings tend to be a lot smaller. But perhaps something excavating a burrow, maybe? I don't see any signs of yummy termites that an aardvark would be after. So just one of those mysteries. The soil's hard, so there's no sign or tracks of an aardvark. It's been rained upon, so it's not fresh. But it is interesting. I'm just talking about the different tracks and signs of the bush. Okay, mystery hole. Goodbye. I'm going to leave the mystery hole for now. I don't know. Probably aardvark. I just can't work out why. Right, while I continue the search for the mysterious Karula, Brent has been equally mysterious this morning, and he's found something to ask you about.
Well, welcome back, welcome back. So, the quiz for this morning is going to be a mammal quiz, and Aaron in New Zealand was asking for that. Now, mammals, mammals, mammals. Dave, choose a random mammal.
Random mammal, elephant.
Elephant, okay, so there we go. It'll be a quiz on elephants. Okay, At the current moment, which reserve in Africa is said to have the largest body-sized elephants in Africa? So when I say that, the heaviest and tallest at the shoulder. Where will you find the largest body-sized elephants in Africa? If you know the answers, quick, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or type even faster on your email to questions@wildearth.tv. Which reserve in Africa is said to have the largest body-sized elephants, tallest at the shoulder and heaviest in weight? Now, I'm going to meander towards the west a little bit and go have a look around Zoe's area. No one's been there yet this morning. See if we get any luck up there. Of course, the wonderful thing about being on a live safari is that you never know what is around the next corner. So hopefully it'll be something magical, although it is just magical being out in the African bush every day. Like to peer down into these little dry riverbeds. You never know what might be lurking in the shadows. Nothing right now. Now, Jason Curtis has asked for elephant tracks. So we are looking to see if we can see a nice big elephant track. So first answer in for the elephant quiz is incorrect. And it is not Botswana. Okay, no. I thought I saw a track, it was not. Oh. Just trying to, sorry, Andrew's looking for an update on the Nkuhuma lions. So I'm just gonna let him know on the last what we saw. And who knows, maybe we might be lucky enough to bump in to some elephants and we can see them making the tracks. Now, starting to warm up, we might start seeing some birds of prey in the air as the thermals start winding up. I think those vultures have probably finished that buffalo that we were with earlier this morning. We can only hope the hyenas are going to move back soon. Now, next one in for the largest body-sized elephants, and is it the Addo Elephant Park? It is not Addo. Now, the Addo elephants are actually reintroductions from Kruger, strangely enough. So, not Addo Elephant Park, which is in the Eastern Cape of South Africa. Impala everywhere, and I'm just keep scanning for a baby. Well done to curious one, Michael and Mary, who has got the elephant quiz correct. It is indeed Tembe Elephant Park in northern KwaZulu-Natal. Now, we've just been speaking about the world's largest land mammal. Let's go to Jamie with the world's tallest.
The tallest land mammal, and whilst we've been looking for one spotted creature, we have in fact found another. And not just one, but in fact an entire journey of giraffe. And from what I can see, all young males. one large one off on the left and then one tiny little one. Jeepers, that little male is so young, the one standing on the left. He is so, so tiny. He must only just have left the safety of Mom. Hey, little one. Yes, I'm talking about you. Look at this. You can actually see, as young as he is, just how tufted the ossicones are on the top of his head. It's definitely a male. Oh, Brian, he's winking at you. Oh, I think he likes you. It's either you or me, and I'm pretty sure he's looking at you. I know that it's a male. He's got thick, solid ossicones on the top of his head, so they're definitely not thin enough for it to be a female. But he's still really very tiny, and in fact, he's actually even still at the stage where he's slightly disproportionate. His neck is, in comparison to an adult giraffe, is very, very short, which might sound like a silly thing to say because, of course, he's smaller, but it's actually proportionate to his body size. So he's only just left the safety of Mom and joined up with this bachelor group. And that's actually the joy of giraffe. Haha, lots of alliteration here. The joy of a journey of giraffe is that you actually get to see some really interesting interaction. They're not territorial, they're not really herd animals per se. They happen to come and go and meet up as they please. And when you do get a bachelor group of young males like this group, you often see some really interesting interaction and displays of dominance, which is something we were fortunate enough to see just before I went on leave. So quite a few of them. Here comes another one. Also another very, very young male. There we go. Dominance display. Already standing really very close to the younger male, moving right up against him. And what giraffe will do, lots of ruminants do it. It's what's known as mock mounting, where they move up and they mount as if to go and mate with the male, but it's not. It's a display of dominance. Yes, I'm sorry, I'm talking about you. Little one moving closer to the safety of the much larger adult. And he's clearly will be the dominant bull in this collection. He stands a good 3 feet, good meter above the heads of the other giraffe. And there's almost a mentorship type relationship. They're learning a little bit by watching the behavior of this adult male. And he's still young, quite light in color. And yes, you've got to be careful of that, but you'll see that most of the older giraffe bulls in this area have a tendency to go dark brown, sometimes almost black. He's still pale in color and completely flawless. A truly beautiful group, collection of them. Little one stopping to ruminate. I love watching giraffe ruminate. You watch the bolus come back up, and then they chew it, and then they swallow, and rinse, repeat. It's fascinating to watch. And just imagine how powerful those muscles are for that reverse peristalsis to get a ball of cud all the way up from the stomach, right the way up against gravity into the mouth of the giraffe. Look, we've got some synchronized ruminating. Anna Regina, watching on Periscope, you say this is adorable. I agree. I think giraffe are adorable. They're one of my mom's favorite animals. She loves to sit and watch them. Something to do with those gentle eyes and the long eyelashes. I can completely understand why. They are fascinating to just sit and watch. And the nice thing about giraffe is that generally they're animals that are incredibly comfortable with vehicles around them. So you can sit for extended period of time, and the longer you look at them, the weirder they start to look. And I maintain that. I think giraffe are actually truly weird looking. If you sit and watch them for ages, their face starts to look really odd. They've got such odd-shaped noses. And, of course, perfectly designed for what it is they do and the way that they survive. Here's an interesting thing for those of you who are new to these live safaris. We were always taught at school that a giraffe has a long neck so that it can eat food that other animals can't reach. Which, as it turns out, is being dismissed by most evolutionary biologists. Oh, we're off. A journey of giraffe. They're all following that older male. He's looking after them. Evolutionary biologists actually think that giraffe have long necks as pretty much for the same reason that some antelope have very large horns. It's part of a reproductive strategy so that the males can fight each other, and that's how male giraffes do fight, by swinging their necks and hitting each other on the sides. And biologists think that that's actually why a giraffe evolved to have such a long neck, because the giraffe, the male giraffe with the longer neck, got the girl. And they actually have suggested that that's the same reason why some of the dinosaurs, like Diplodocus and Brachiosaurus and so on, one of the reasons why they would have had such long necks as well, especially Diplodocus, less so Brachiosaurus, because Diplodocus was long, Brachiosaurus was tall. And off they go. And Donald Martin, you were wondering if when giraffe fight, and I'm not sure whether you've ever seen any footage of giraffe fighting. I know we've seen it once or twice in quite a half-hearted way on these live safaris. You're wondering if they ever kill each other. Yes, but very occasionally. It does happen if it's a really, truly serious fight. The power of those necks and the momentum that they gather and on the sort of the length of the neck, it creates a very powerful blow. And what sometimes happens is that the male, the sort of the victor, will sweep the feet out of the giraffe that it's attacking. And as soon as the giraffe falls down, it actually can't control the movement of its head. So what often happens is, not often, occasionally, very rarely happens, is that they fall down and they knock their heads. And that can actually kill them. It's unusual, but it does every now and again happen. But if you see a giraffe after a really, truly serious fight, you'll see they've got massive, massive internal bruising. You can see the bruising all along their bodies, and it actually breaks the skin very regularly. Now, I'm going to go and search for a different spotted creature. In the meantime, Brent has found another feathered friend.
It's a very upset feathered friend, and I'm wondering if there isn't a snake here. He's been alarm calling incessantly. Of course, now he keeps quiet. There might have been a snake that just snuck through there and crested Franklin, was alarm calling. So we've made our way all the way to Zoe's Road. No one's checked just yet this morning, so hopefully we'll find some sign of something fantastic. It is amazing what a difference a couple of weeks makes and how green it is. Still not that real big grass flush just yet, and we probably need one or two more rains to really get a nice carpet of emerald green along the ground. But it is heating up, I guess. What do you think, Dave? 32, 33 already. And it's not even 8 a.m. in the morning. So I think today is going to definitely be a scorcher. Might have to make use of the swimming pool once or twice. Hi, Aaron. Now, Aaron said it's probably been asked before. What does Juma mean? Now, there's a bit of debate about that. Originally, it was thought to mean the lion's roar, but it's not. It's actually a contact call of the lions. Angaria Juma, they're talking. And that's, as far as I know, that's what Juma means. So that little contact call between lions. Now, no tracks this side yet. I'm hoping we might find some ellies. I've been looking for an elephant footprint and there just don't seem to be any around. There we go, we're coming to one of my favourite vistas on Juma shortly. On the junction of Zoe's and Rebecca's Road. And you get to look down towards the east. And you never know what we might spot from the high ground. Okay, here we go. And but what are we going to see from the vista today? I think we're going to see a waterbuck. There's one male waterbuck. Let me just get into a spot where we can see him clearly. There we go. Here is the nice... Where is he? He just keeps moving behind bushes. Well, we made for him to keep moving. We've got a little crowned lapwing. Here we go. A bird of the short grasses. They don't like long grass. You're never going to find a lapwing on long grass. Always find them on short grass. And great lovers of airstrips as well. Very pretty little bird. Where's this waterbuck? There he comes. Slowly but surely out of the thickets. Yeah, big male waterbuck. I was hoping maybe to spot some elephants from up here. You can hear how the birds are slowly stopping to call so much as it gets really, really hot. And I can hear some birds making lots of noise, which I'm going to go look for right now. And they are very, very cool little birds. And when they're making noise like that, they tend to stand up quite prominently. Well, while we look for birds of a feather, it seems like Jamie's got a feather of her own.
Well, I have absolutely, unfortunately, no idea what Brent was talking about because I cannot hear Rebecca clearly, but I did catch the word live, so I'm assuming that we are, in fact, live. And we've got something speaking about the heat of the day. I know Brent was saying how the birds have gone quiet because it's getting so hot. Here's an animal that's found themselves a really good spot to spend their sort of the rest of their day. What have we got here? Have we got some young boys? Or is it a whole bachelor herd? What have we got? Oh no, it's the remains of a breeding herd, actually. Hi, guys. I want to stop between you and water. Shame. Some very hot, very tired-looking buffalo. A young male there, and then a couple of... one female. Whenever you see one female like this, and I know immediately she's a female just by the amount of hair around the base of her horns, whenever you see a female like this separated from the main body of a breeding herd, you immediately can draw a conclusion as to what those buffalo have been through. And almost invariably, it's been chased by lions. She looks absolutely stunning. You don't often say that about buffalo. There are a lot of things, but beautiful I don't think is necessarily one of them. And in that glowing backlight of the morning, they actually look really stunning. That rich brown coat. And of course, all of our buffalo really, really struggling to sort of get back to the condition that they were in before the drought. Two very hard years of very little food and grazing and water. And as a result, we're seeing lots of prominent bones. They will survive. Not all of them, but the strongest ones will. And we'll see a massive recovery in population over the next few years. And for the Nkuhumas, this has been an absolute boon. Hello, guys. They're browsing, which is always interesting. And we see it happen. Buffalo are bulk grazers. They don't really have the digestive system for feeding off leaves. But that being said, buffalo don't read the textbooks. And so nibbling off fresh green leaves is probably one of the only avenues open to them in terms of actually managing to find the nutrients that they need. There's very, very little grass to actually sustain them. Most of the greenery is perennial plants. Oh, where's that oxpecker gone? Ducked behind. As always accompanied by their cohort of oxpeckers. There's a very heavy stillness in the air already. What time is it? 7:30. Unbelievably hot for this time of day. Oh well, summer is here. Apparently a dragonfly keeps photobombing us. Brian, did you see it?
I did.
You did see it. I did not. I do have a glare on my monitor, though. Apparently there's a dragonfly fluttering about as well, which makes absolute sense. Because this is a spot with lots and lots of water and mud wallows. And the oxpeckers have picked their favourite. And there we go, one of the females slowly but surely making her way towards one of those water holes to go and have a drink and to go and slack her thirst. So that's where the dragonflies are coming from. Predatory, fast-moving insects. Now, Rob, you're wondering about an interesting point, which I think has actually happened relatively recently. You wanted to know if a buffalo were to die in the water or in one of the water holes, and if it hadn't been killed by a predator, wasn't being eaten by a predator, would we remove it in order to prevent it from contaminating the water holes? And the answer is yes. We do, just in terms of the fact that a lot of these animals, their water holes are their only source of water. There are a few puddles around at the moment. If a buffalo were to go and die in this mud wallow, then it would probably be left. And the contamination of the water would just be inevitable. But that mud wallows are going to dry. Those mud wallows are going to dry up very, very soon, unless we have more rain. But I know that a buffalo was dragged out of Biffles Hook Dam, or out of being right next to Biffles Hook Dam. There was a dead buffalo in Red Dam. If you cast your mind back a couple of months, with lots and lots of vultures and the hyenas sitting on it in the middle of the dam, once the hyenas moved off, then that carcass was also dragged out of the water to stop it from contaminating the only water sources that we have. And that is a product of the fact that these water holes are all man-made, hence that level of interference with them. That's why they pull the buffalo carcasses out. And the same goes for giraffe, elephants, anything like that. And as our buffaloes slowly but surely make their way off in the direction of some fresh water, Brent once again has... Oh, I forgot about the feather in my hat. We'll talk about that later. Let's go and have a look at which bird Brent has found.
Oh, it was spotted by Dave. Oh, he's going to fly. It's a martial eagle. No, he's not going to fly. But we can hear the squirrels chittering away. And of course, the martial eagle means death from above for a lot of small creatures. Now, it looks like you might have spotted something. Not sure what he's doing. Now, they generally fly quite quickly, so that's why we stopped so far away, to make sure we got a view of him. Let's get a bit closer. Hopefully he doesn't take off. Come on, come on, let's get there. Slowly, slowly, slowly. I think we're trying to get you the nice view of his beautiful chest. Very diagnostic. I think we'll get another safety shot from here, just in case. Can you hear all the squirrels alarming? Now it's the biggest eagle we get here. And the wingspan of around 2 meters. Now, one of their favorite foods in the next month or so is going to be impala lambs. So this eagle's big enough to grab a baby impala and fly off with it. You can see in silhouette there one of those massive talons. This one seems to be being quite nice to us. So let's try and get a little bit closer again. Very slowly, slowly. You ready, Dave? Just in case it takes off. Wow. Normally they take off long before this. You can see those incredible yellow eyes. Now, just trying to see. Oh, look at that, look at it turning around there. Okay, let's push our luck even more, Dave. Let's go try and get a nice frontal view of him. Get past that stick. Here we go, I think that's our best view. You can see the white dappled chest. See that in the spots there. So it's an adult marshal. You can see those massive feet now. Look at that. Now, another one of their favorite foods is that monitor lizards. Now, it's not uncommon to find a marshal sitting atop a tree munching on a monitor. Constantly on the lookout for dinner, breakfast and lunch. Of course, like most of our eagle species, they are diurnal, so you don't find them flying about at night. Oh, look at the sun catching the eye there. Oh, Jamie says, this is an awesome eagle. Indeed it is. And I said, we don't see them that often. It's quite nice to actually get this close. Normally they take off long before here. They even will eat small tortoises. And the reason I say tortoise, we'll go catch up with the tortoise. No, there was a tortoise crossing the road behind us. But it looked a bit big for this particular eagle. There we go, wait for that. He's going to turn and wait till the light catches those magnificent eyes. You just see the focus of a predator in those eyes. Come on, turn a little bit, catch the sunlight. Now, sometimes they're seen in pairs, more than often seen solitary, even though they do mate in pairs, but they can cover vast distances, the Marshall Eagles. Magnificent creature. Well, I'm worried we're going to lose that tortoise, so hopefully the eagle stays there. Let's go see the tortoise, who's highly mobile. Right, Charles is wondering how big are those talons. They can get up to about 5 or 6 centimeters in length, so absolutely massive. Okay, where is that tortoise now? Saw him crossing the road around here somewhere. Maybe it was a highly mobile tortoise. We could have stopped under that little bush. Yes, 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 yes. Now where is he? Crossed around here. You got him. Ah, there we go. It's a highly mobile leopard tortoise. He got much further than I thought he was going to get. That nice armor deplating, protecting him from the Marshall Eagles. as a lot of you might notice, we don't see any tortoises outside of the summer months, and they go into astation. So they don't go hibernate, but they don't feed. They just stick to an area and they'll just rest up. But now with this green flush and lots of pans around, we're probably going to be seeing quite a lot of tortoises out and about. Yeah, engage 4x4, get over the branch. Oh, off he goes. That was a nice little interlude. Oh, and while we've had our backs turned, the martial eagle has departed. We're going to continue back on to Impala Road, check towards Sandy Patch. I'm hoping for some elephants still. Now, Anna Marie is wondering how much larger is a martial eagle than a fish eagle? Considerably larger, Anna Marie. Probably in weight wise, a good couple of kilograms, height, probably a good 10 centimeters or so. I will double check the exact figures for you. So there we go, fish eagle is, exact figures, weighs, it gets to about 68 centimeters in height and weighs about 2.5 kilograms. And we'll have a look at the comparison now. Oh. Okay, now we gotta find the martial eagle. Whoopsie. There we go, martial eagle. So about double the size. So, and height wise gets to 81 centimeters. So I get 10 to 15 centimeters bigger. And weight, double the size. Gets to about 4.5 to 5 kilograms as a fish eagle's 2.5. Wonder what wonders Impala Road is going to lead us towards. Well, it seems to be no Ellie's around here today, so I think I'm going to start heading back towards the north slightly. I was hoping even if there weren't any Ellie's around, there might be some zebra general game. I think Quarantine might be a good spot to go check. Let's do that. And oh, it is heating up quickly. Wonder where Queen Karula is. She's got to be around somewhere, and we're pretty sure she's on Juma, but she just managed to give us all the slip this morning. Not even a zebra or a wildebeest out here on the open area. Remember, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you would like to send us a question. This is indeed a live African safari, and we are in sunny South Africa, very sunny South Africa today. Probably, I think, by the sunset safari, the mercury might tip at over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, Hunter's wondering how many dams or water holes do we have in the Kruger? Well, wow, I would not be able to answer that, Hunter, but on Juma, twin dams, treehouse, we got four. Now, of course, those are man-made dams. There's lots of natural water holes as well. Chelepan, Gwaripan, various other little mud wallows and pans all over the place. But man-made structures, four. Five, including Gallagher. Now, Marie's wondering, why is Treehouse Dam called Treehouse Dam when there's no treehouse there? Well, there used to be a treehouse many, many years ago. So Treehouse Dam is actually one of the only natural seeps where water seeps through from the earth in this area. Now, there was a treehouse, a hunting platform there in the 50s and 40s. Of course, the hunting hasn't been happening since the 60s in the Sabi Sands, so the treehouse slowly just disintegrated. There's the odd piece of wire and a pole up in the tree. Next time I'm there, Marie, remind me and I will go show you what is left of the treehouse dam. Here we go, some impala and inyala. First animals we've seen in quite a while. Look at that, there's a red-billed oxpecker. Oh, it was quickly booted off by the... Oh, back again. The Nyala is not having any of it. Here's the little one behind. I love the little white chevrons on their nose. Very pretty antelope. Oh, and oxpeckers. Not very popular oxpeckers this morning. They've flown off. We're going to do the same. We're going to keep heading towards quarantine. There seems to be a magpie strike conference going on. Much talking. There we go. There they are. There we go. They're all making lots of noise. Oh, off they go. Now, they live in little flocks, one left, and they will actually defend their territory against other flocks of magpie shrikes, quite often very violently. But it seems like the morning magpie shrike conference is over, so let's go back to Jamie and see what she's been up to.
And so we continue the search for the Queen of Juma. Aubrey's been out on foot walking in the block. We've been trying to give him a hand by circling. Okay, we might have circled once or twice more than I intended to, but we've circled the blocks repeatedly. We've managed to confirm that she is definitely inside one particular patch of vegetation, and now it's just a question of narrowing it down. So I'm afraid to say, and I'm so sorry if it's not exciting, but I think everything's exciting, and we've got the prospect of a leopard, so it is exciting. But we are going back to the point where we left the tracks and where Aubrey's gone off to go and find her. If anyone can help us find her, Aubrey and Taxon can. They've come to know the animals exceptionally well. Oh, it's a good... I'm still hoping. I know we're getting to the end of the sunrise safari. And if we don't find her this morning, we'll search for her this afternoon. But I have a feeling we're going to get her. How many minutes have we got? 20. We're going to find her, Brian.
No, we've
got 10.
Yeah.
Oh, no. That's disastrous. Okay, so we're really cutting it fine. The great search for the Queen Karula. That's taken up 3 hours. I'd have to go for a walk. Hello, little ones. Okay, so we'll chat a little bit about my peculiar headdress in a moment. Just stop and enjoy some time spent with the Inyala, since they're all standing so obligingly in the shade. Morning, little ones. Oh, there's a little male at the back. That's my favourite. I don't know why, but there's just something about the young, particularly the young spiral-horned antelope when they're males, that I find incredibly appealing. I think it's the gangly, fluffy look where they haven't quite transitioned between the sort of female colouring and the youngster colouring and their adult dark colouring. Definitely one of my favourite antelope to sit and spend time with. They are so beautiful. And pregnant, in the case of this large female. Right, so Anna Marie wanted to know about the feather in my head, the feather in my cap, so to speak. I happened to pick it up on the road, and I've put it there for safekeeping, because otherwise if it goes in the vehicle, they tend to get quite squashed. So your guess is as good as mine as to what on earth this particular feather happened to be. It's beautiful, that much I can say. It almost looks as though those are white fingerprints on the feather itself. And my guess would be it might be something like an owl. There's a fringe along the edges there that maybe, because the fringes of owl feathers, sorry, hold on one second. The fringes of owl feathers on the outside edge are slightly serrated in order to break the flow of air and therefore to allow for slightly more silent movement. But this I'm not sure if is just damage, natural damage that's been done. But look how beautiful this feather is. Look at the incredible detail and what miracles of biological engineering a feather truly is. I have no idea what this particular feather came or which bird this feather came from. I guessed an owl, but it could have been something like a corhan. It's not something like a frank. It's quite a long flight feather. So it's quite a large bird. I'm going to take it back to the tent for James. And of course there will be discussions about which particular bird it comes from. But I feel like it suits that hatch. It's a perfect spot for it. And it's far less likely to get squashed and wrecked. Don't you think that's a perfect spot, Brian?
It is.
Fits nicely. Right, sorry, I was trying to get a hold of Aubrey earlier, and he's just called through to me. Aubs, sorry, I was just wondering where your last tracks were. Okay, copy that. Thank you. It's a mystery where she went. Copy. Thanks, Orbs. Sorry, everybody. We're trying to puzzle out the mystery as to where Karula disappeared to with her cubs. We all agree that she's probably got a kill somewhere. Aubrey's walked in this block, he's walked in that block, and she just seems to have melted somewhere into the vegetation. So while we do one more chance loop in that area to see if we can spot her, let's go across to Brent, see if he's managed to get to quarantine yet.
We've made it to quarantine, but alas, there's not even an impala so far. But we're only halfway through the loop of the quarantine clearings. So we're going to keep going, see what else we can find. Okay, so as you can see, quite empty at the moment. Now, it could be the heat that the animals have moved off to other areas to feed. I might take a little gander down towards the dam cam, see if there's anything just behind there that we haven't been able to see from where we've been checking so far. I can hear a Deirdre's cuckoo calling. Alas, quarantine is mammal-free, but it's definitely not avian-free. And in this wonderful light, let's have a quick look at the iridescent shining of a glossy starling. Look at that sheen, that magnificent colour. Now, as a male starling, the shinier you are, the more girls you get. So, it is to do with condition. So when a starling is in absolutely splendid colour like this one, it means very good condition. And when they start to lose condition, they get a little bit drab, not quite as shiny as that. Right, there we go, glossy starlings. But apart from the glossy starling, there seems to be very little else. Who knows? You never know. That's the joy of a live safari. And it is so great to be back in at Juma and back with Safari Live. And I'm very excited for the next couple of months of drives. I think we're going to have a fantastic summer season. Right, for the last little bit of drive, Dangerous Dave and I are going to bid you adieu and send you back to Jamie for hopefully a little bit of Karula luck.
Well, unfortunately, our search for the lovely Queen Karula has not been at all successful this morning. Despite three of us desperately searching for her, we'll just have to try again this afternoon. We'll find her on the Sunset Safari. She can't be that far away because we haven't found any tracks crossing the road, so she cannot have gone that far. He must be somewhere in this general vicinity. We'll just have to try again this afternoon, and perhaps even she might come through to one of the water holes for a drink. And we can start from scratch once again in terms of finding her. We know she's here. She's on Juma. The Queen has returned. It's just a matter of tracking Her Royal Highness down. Hopefully she's got a nice big kill that will, especially as it starts to get hot, that perhaps perhaps the carcass might even attract something like a tawny eagle or a bataleer. And as soon as we see them perched in trees around her, we're going to have a much easier time of trying to track down where she is. We'll just have to wait until the Sunset Safari this afternoon to find out if we manage to find her. We will. We will find her. Brian, is Herbie on leave?
I'm not sure, actually.
Me neither. I haven't seen him since I got back, come to think of it. Might have to go and see if I can find Herbie. Perhaps we'll go for a walk in between drives, depending on what the day has in store for us. It is lovely to be back, though, and enjoying. I think today is going to be a pool day. There's going to be several dips in the swimming pool to cool down. Well, we know where she didn't go. We'll just have to track down and find where she did go. In the meantime, however, it's time for us to return to the enormous breakfast spoils that Wild Earth always manages to provide, this time cooked by a lovely lady called Happiness, which I feel is very, very appropriate as she is providing breakfast. So on that note, it is a time for us to say a farewell and do all of our thank yous once again. Oh, and I might have to try and do this quickly because we're about to have a long chat with Aubrey. So a big thank you to Brian for his fantastic camera work, as always, as well as to Rebecca and to Jerry in Final Control, and I'm sure you'll all join me in welcoming Rebecca and Jerry back once again. And most importantly, a big thank you to all of you watching across the globe. I hope you had a marvelous time despite our lack of leopards, and I hope you'll join us for the Sunset Safari this afternoon. Until we see you then, have a wonderful day.